Rotorua is a jewel in our tourism crown. But when COVID hit hard, its famous gateway, the motels of Fenton Street, went from holiday to emergency housing. And now, many locals are at their wits' end. Gangs, drugs, fires, their town, they say, has become dangerous. But for those living in the motels, things are even worse. So who's all this actually helping? Kristin Hall with this exclusive investigation.
Mythical, mystical Rotorua. It's the birthplace of tourism in New Zealand and a mecca for visitors seeking culture, adrenaline, and a landscape quite unlike any other. But there's a dark side to this beautiful city.
You've been here for a year and a half.
Yep.
You and four kids and a dog.
There are major problems in these motels. We're waiting for someone to die.
The first week out, I was seeing a couple of guards rolling up in their black power patches.
We've heard allegations of negligence, intimidation, and abuse of power towards some of our most vulnerable.
I'm getting pushed out of my house and there's nowhere for me to go.
Carried out by agencies who are receiving millions of taxpayer dollars to look after them.
The government has to give me authorization for that. People just the shit on me. Then I have a reporter like you.
Rotorua's Fenton Street, or the Golden Mile as it's affectionately known, was once a tourist hub. Motels as far as the eye can see.
Rotorua is shifting. It's taken on a new image. The signs now are reminiscent of Miami Beach.
Well, the police have been actively gathering detailed information on rising rates of crime and violence at emergency housing.
So we're off to go see a woman called Carolyn. She's lived near Fenton Street for around 25 years, but in the last few years, she says she's noticed a real change in the area, a real uptick in crime and some pretty scary behaviour. She's a little bit nervous about speaking to us.
We built this house for our family. And, I don't know if it'll be for our forever house. That hurts.
When did things start to change?
I would say about 3 years ago, we started to see a little community starting to build up of rough sleepers. And all of a sudden, COVID happens, and we have people being put into motels, and then the issues there started to happen. The cop cars, the language, the violence that we've witnessed. Actually, the worst one was when I had to ring the police. All I could hear was very loud, aggressive language being thrown at a child who was just crying and screaming. So I literally rang 111 and held the phone up to the fence saying to the lady, "Can you not hear this? You need to get somebody here straight away."
Carolyn is not alone. One Fenton Street resident we spoke to sleeps with a bat next to his door, used to watching scraps like this
rumble
right outside his window. Another nearby local told us of multiple burglary attempts, including one by a child. And then there are the fires, four motel blazes in less than a year.
Come back in our place where he lives on fire. We're probably going to have to move out here, and this is probably the best spot that I've found in emergency housing.
Late last year, part of this motel was gutted. We spoke with a fire and emergency worker whose voice we've disguised.
Well, there were no smoke alarms in the rooms at the Golden Glow. They were sitting in a fire, not installed.
A motel staff member told us emergency housing clients often remove smoke alarms or take the batteries out.
How dangerous are some of these motels?
There are major problems. We're waiting for someone to die.
In fact, it may only be a matter of time before someone does die. The Four Canoes Hotel is where the Housing Ministry has placed a number of highly vulnerable homeless people, including those with addictions and serious mental health issues. A report leaked to Sunday shows Fens is extremely concerned about its use. After a blaze which destroyed a room late last year, a risk investigator found there were no smoke alarms or sprinklers in the hotel. They concluded the occupants were likely to be killed or injured in the event of a fire. Some residents have been moved on, but not all.
We're on Fenton Street at the moment, and to really get a sense of what's changed here, you kind of just have to go for a drive along. So this motel here is emergency housing. So is this one. So is this one. So is this one next to it. So is this one here. So either on Fenton Street or within a 500 metre radius of Fenton Street, there are, as far as we're aware, 50 emergency housing motels, which is a huge number in such a small area.
It's recording.
Yeah, it is recording.
Cruise, not so loud.
In this city, more than 500 households are living in emergency motels. Mike's Farno is one of them.
Our little fridge over here has just got a big ass ice block in it.
Oh my gosh.
It's got no freezer. So we don't got no freezer, no oven. Had to turn around and get this little wee oven here.
Oh, you're
which is
oh my gosh.
Just to cook pies in that. And
so that's what you get to cook on for five people?
Yep. We haven't had a roast or anything since we left our other house.
And how long ago was that?
Over a year and a half ago.
Their two-room unit is lined with tumbling towers of belongings, a constant reminder of the four-bedroom home they rented before it was sold.
I heard the blanket.
You run too fast. He's just got a bad case of ADHD.
Is this enough space for a kid with lots of energy?
Oh, hell no. He was going in and closing himself in the bathroom to find his own space so he could kick back and play.
Downstairs, Mike shares a bed with dog Hulk and his daughter. Upstairs, 10-year-old Cruz sleeps on the floor next to his two older brothers. Mike's son Lucky says neighbours in Fenton Street motels include criminals and patched gang members.
I'd say Fenton Street's like the dog's hood, like that's their main territory. It's like a hood. Like the block, and there's always drama out of here. And yeah, it's hard to stay out of it, especially when we're living right beside it.
Spas in most rooms and a honeymoon suite, reads the sign outside.
This room, you know how much is being charged for it?
Yep, $1,080 a week.
$1,080 for this place a week?
Yep.
Are you serious?
Yep. Serious as.
Wow.
And as hard as it is to believe, that might actually be a bargain. Our producer went undercover at this emergency housing motel, where the charge is $150 a night for regular guests and $209 a night for those staying under the emergency housing system, a cost to taxpayers of over $1,400 a week.
Room rate is $209.
It was $150 last night, and now it, you said it's $210.
So I have given you discounted.
Right, but Wins will pay the full amount.
They will pay the full amount.
The manager says the price is fair because emergency housing clients use more electricity.
You can just wash the things again.
Yeah.
If you want, right?
Yeah, I might do that.
Yep. Because I'm just putting the spray here.
So we've just checked into what's probably one of the worst motels in the city that's doing emergency housing and accepting tourists in as well. It absolutely reeks. Everything is just kind of a bit wet. This place hasn't had a clean in a bloody long time because this is all like black mold spots here. Oh, there's something in the sink. Oh my god, this is all rusted as. I think that's like white mold in there.
Cigarette burn in my pillow. Right there. How good.
That looks like that's probably from someone trying to bust in or out, which is comforting.
A string of one-star reviews show other visitors have been equally shocked. They reference violent and abusive behaviour from fellow guests and late-night parties. Many appear not to have known they were staying in an emergency housing motel. And it's the same story for a number of other motels across the city.
How concerned are you about the reputation of Rotorua?
Well, it's an iconic visitor destination and it must remain that. Visitors must feel safe here.
Former Labor Minister and outgoing Rotorua Mayor Steve Chadwick.
Would you feel safe walking down Fenton Street alone at night?
Not at night, but I do walk that street often, but I'm much more cautious now. I know the motels that are troublesome.
She's written to government twice in the last year calling for a ban on emergency motels offering tourist accommodation, as well as begging ministers to stem the flow of homeless people arriving from out of town.
So are you successfully getting the government's attention?
Yes, I believe we are. This is a highly complex issue. I get people that I know saying, Steve, shut them down. We don't have that mechanism.
Up next, vulnerable tenants speak out.
Why are you scared of them?
Because I'm getting pushed out of my house and there's nowhere for me to go.
Do you feel like they're helping? They're called visions of a helping hand. Do you feel
they're not helping? And they haven't been since I've been under them.
People just shit on me. Then I have a reporter like you. You go through the right panels from now on.
We're in Rotorua, home of so many natural wonders that are the city's biggest moneymaker.
Connect to the elements here like nowhere else on Earth.
But there's a new emerging industry in this city, homelessness. Motels raking in millions, as well as the companies contracted to look after those who live in them. The biggest operator is a big name around town.
Tiny and Lily, we're going to put you on camera now. It's lovely to have you both with us.
Please put your hands together for Tiny Dean and his wife, Lynn Lee.
A former truck driver, Tiny Dean, launched his charity, Visions of a Helping Hand, 5 years ago. It started as a night shelter and is now a large-scale operation providing social services and accommodation for thousands.
I'm just a Maori boy from Coromandel that has a big heart and has a lot of common sense.
The government's paid the charity nearly $14 million since 2017.
Would be one of the biggest in New Zealand. I look after more families in South Asia and Army, Emerge, Lifewise, and Dara in the whole of New Zealand.
Less well known is Tiny Dean's security company, where he is the sole director. Previously called Visions Security, the name was changed to Tigers Express Security in May. And they're contracted to provide services to Visions of a Helping Hand.
Legally, I cannot talk about that.
Oh, why is that?
Because we're in a collective.
What does that mean?
It means that we're governed.
Governed by who? Were you worried about talking to us at all?
A little bit.
Why?
Because you're so straight as square. And so, you know, it's like talking to the police almost. And just not getting incriminated for it. But you know what I mean?
Sarita is a tough cookie with a tough past. A recovered pee addict, she says the Fenton Street motels where she lived for 8 months are the place to score.
There's definitely drug dealers that stay there where people will come in and knock on the door at all hours of the morning. So there's a shop right there that you can just go and knock on, you know, room 5. Go have a look.
A pee shop?
Yeah. So at the time, I was smoking drugs myself, so it worked. It was good. But when you want to make things better. It's really, really hard.
It was no place for children.
My daughter and some other kids were playing. My daughter got pepper sprayed by the police accidentally. They had come in the middle of the day to search for someone who had a warrant for the arrest. So we left there, because obviously that's scary.
Sarita and five of her kids moved to a government-contracted motel, becoming clients of Visions of a Helping Hand, watched over by Tiny Dean's security guards.
They would be searching your pockets, searching your room at any time. When you leave, you had to give your room key so they could tell whenever you were leaving and coming back, every time you left. It felt invasive, you know, like you could probably go to prison and not be under so much pressure.
Hi, Kristin.
Nice to see you. Cool, take a seat.
My name's Brett Wilson. I've been in the security industry for over 30 years. I'm also on the board of the New Zealand Security Association.
What sorts of people have you heard are being employed to work as security guards by Visions?
Security staff have been involved in sexual relations with vulnerable tenants and probably exploiting their position there. General poor behaviour and handling of conflict situations. Employment of unlicensed guards, and including those with gang connections and significant list of criminal convictions.
How do you know that?
Because the licensed guards are working there are telling me. So there are a number who keep contacting me and saying this isn't on, this isn't acceptable.
For Sarita, the worst incident came after her teenage son was accused of jumping the motel fence.
A truck pulled in with a whole truckload of security guards, and I said, are you here for my 15-year-old? And he said, yeah, where the f*** is he? We want to talk to him, and started unzipping his jacket and walking towards my room. And I'm in onesies, pregnant as, late as. I'm trying to run in front of him so he can't get to my door, and he's pushing me to the side. And at this point, we had five security guards surrounding me and my son. They were screaming at him, telling him that, you know, does he think he's tough? My 9-year-old drops to her knees, that's all on the camera Visions, and says, please leave my brother alone, and started crying.
And what was it like seeing your children like that?
That was heartbreaking, just to see her drop, like, and actually beg. She went like this and said, please leave my brother alone. So that was pretty hard. Sorry.
They left and never returned.
What were your kids saying when you were suggesting that you went back and just stayed just the night?
No, mummy. What do I want them to come and give us? You're hiding in the middle of the night, you know, don't I care that they're scared? So they would rather sleep in the car. So be it, at least we were all together and they felt safer.
What's not so safe is for Tiger security staff to be speaking to us. Their jobs are on the line, but they've done it on the condition of anonymity.
The first thing out I got was seeing a couple of guards rolling up in their black power patches. That was one thing that just blew me away. I thought, holy shit, how did people like that get a license? You have to have a clean record to get a security license. There were a couple of issues with random guards. I was to be going into random rooms where they shouldn't have been, mainly the single moms. A couple were caught pants down, if you know what I mean.
How do you think this company was able to gain a security license?
Well, I will argue they shouldn't have been able to.
Friday night, after dark, Mum Aidan climbs through a broken window to feed her whānau.
Thank you. Look, just buy a mitch, buy you guys some kai. My babies were in here because it was getting too cold. She was getting hōhau sitting in the car. And so when I broke the window, my baby had been passed through the window so I could get her inside, as well as the rest of the kids.
Yeah. Are they kind of wondering what's going on right now?
They think I've lost my key.
Right.
Yeah.
Is that what you told them?
Mm.
Right.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to have to tell them kind of what's really going on.
They're too young, eh? Like,
The truth is, the locks were changed at the home Aidan rented through visions of a helping hand, her belongings still inside.
Where would you have been if you couldn't get into your house?
In my car. I have a gazebo around the back there, and I was gonna pitch that up over my car and sleep in there with my baby. And just give her cold bottles from out of the tap, the outside tap. Oh, I'm actually pretty scared because I don't know if I'm gonna get in big trouble for this. Yeah, I'm scared of visions, yeah.
Why are you scared of them?
Because the attitude that they give when they knock at my door, they stand over me a lot. They lie, they like tell me things that I've did, but I didn't do that. And I'm just tired because I'm getting pushed out of my house and there's nowhere for me to go.
One of the reasons visions gave for Aidan's eviction was that she had an unauthorised visitor. That visitor was her sister Jax, who was house-sitting here earlier this year while heavily pregnant. She went into labour 3 weeks early, but when Vision's staff arrived...
They could see me. They could see me labouring. I was fully labouring on the ground. I wanted to push, but I couldn't. Because yep. Natalie's standing there over the top of me telling me I have to leave, you got to get out. I said, but I'm having my baby on here. Well, what do I do? She says, just get out. Otherwise, I'm calling security.
Where did you go?
I laboured in my car.
When Jax's baby died 2 weeks later, visions of a helping hand paid for the cremation. Jax, a former resident of this Visions Run motel, says she'd been forced to sleep in her car during her pregnancy when guards wouldn't let her access her room.
I had been arguing with Tiny right through my pregnancy and the security guards.
About what mostly?
Just getting in.
Yeah.
Just getting into my motel. There's always a fight.
A week after her baby's death, Jax received a visit from Tiny Dean.
He apologised for baby passing.
And how did that make you feel to hear that?
At the time, I was just saying, yep, not realising what was going on. But now that I think about it, I have so much to say to him.
Next.
Yeah, that's him. Let's go.
He's responsible for their housing and the security. So what does Tiny Dean have to say?
Kristin from Sunday. We're wanting to have a chat to you.
Hi, Colin. Kristin.
There's a long list of questions that we want to ask you. Have vulnerable women been kicked out of their homes under your watch?
With too few houses and far too many people doing it tough, managing emergency housing in Rotorua has become a big business. Vulnerable whānau with nowhere else to go sign up with providers hoping things will get better. Instead, there are allegations of intimidation, sexual misconduct and abuse of power against Rotorua's largest emergency housing provider and its security company.
Can I give you a hug?
We've spoken to three homeless mothers.
I have keys, but none of them will fit. I'm so tired.
Whose experiences with visions of a helping hand and Tiger security are shocking.
And he said to me, what's your daughter fucking crying for? We're not scary.
But they're not isolated. Other Visions clients have told us access to motel rooms is strictly controlled by security, that guards enter rooms at any time.
We're asking what's on your receipt. What did you go shopping for?
Checking our cars.
If you object, clients say, you might be threatened with gang violence or be kicked out on the street, left with nowhere to go.
So we've been trying for a month now to get an interview with Tiny Dean. He keeps giving us excuses as to why he can't talk to us, directed us to his lawyer and to the board. Neither of them would answer any of our questions. So the last resort is to show up to head office and see if he'll talk to us. Yeah, that's him. Let's go.
Tiny.
Hey.
Kristin from Sunday. We're wanting to have a chat to you.
No comment, Kristin.
There's a long list of questions that we want to ask you, complaints that some of the tenants of Visions of a Helping Hand have, and people have been looked after by Tiger Security.
Can no comment. Speak to our lawyer, please.
Why not? We'd really like to talk to you, Tiny. Have vulnerable women been kicked out of their homes under your watch? Have you ever had gang members working security?
Here we go. Mm-hmm. Yeah, well done. I'm going
to type for you. Tiny, have you kicked vulnerable women out of their homes?
No comment. I can't speak. Our board has advised me against that. We've done nothing wrong.
But you are the CEO. Why can't you answer our questions?
Because I'm bound by law. We have a collective here, so... Best thing, if anything, is just go see the government.
Government doesn't run these operations, you do.
Yeah. Once our lawyer gives us all the go-ahead, we'll go ahead. But, you know, one thing I can't get over is that we do so much good in this town and yet you guys are trying to crucify us for it.
Well, to be fair, Tony, we asked you for an interview quite a while ago before we were aware of these claims and you said you couldn't do an interview then either.
I can't.
So claims generally.
That have made those claims, you come back with their names and then we can talk.
Well, some of them are scared of you and your team, not. Tiny. They are. No, I'm telling you, they are scared of you and your security guards.
Names or anything, you know, because I don't know who they are or if they give me permission to talk about them. And then I can discuss matters with you.
Did you or any of your staff order Jax Hovell out of her sister's place while she was in labour? There's a specific question.
No, we didn't.
You didn't. You weren't there. You didn't do that. Your staff had nothing to do with that.
No, I wasn't there. It was just a ruling that was made.
Did your staff... We sent those details to Tiny Dean and Visions of a Helping Hand via their lawyer, but they refuted all the claims and declined to comment. So we went to Housing Minister Megan Woods.
So I think that there have been some allegations that certainly I took seriously in terms of what our people who are working on the ground in Rotorua are finding, is that actually there is no cause for us to say that someone shouldn't be in a position to provide services. We're working with a cohort of people who have very complex lives. There are a large number of vulnerabilities and I'm very mindful of that.
Does that mean that their claims shouldn't be taken seriously?
No, they are taken seriously.
Should these companies still be working with highly vulnerable people while there are such allegations against them?
The kinds of claims that you're talking about, they would be criminal. I've taken the step of asking the officials to reach out to the local police. They have told us that there are no concerns in terms of the operation on the ground.
What would it take to end the relationship with Visions and Tiger Security? Because this is serious stuff.
Certainly, if I was told anywhere in the country that any organisation was putting our people at risk, I would take action.
Will you look into that again?
If there is a cause for me to look at things, of course I will.
And when it comes to ending emergency motels in Rotorua, what's the government's plan?
We could cancel those motel contracts tomorrow. The motel problem for Rotorua would be over, but would be back to the problem that was there when I became the minister, and that was people sleeping in the doorways of shops. Let's be really clear what the alternatives are.
It's been 3 weeks since we last spoke to Aidan and Jax. In the few text messages Jax has sent, she sounded really distressed. It's the middle of winter, they have 3 kids, and they're homeless.
So this is the life we've got to put up with. Thanks to Tiny Dean, he left us all homeless, and this is our house.
In Papamoa, an hour's drive from Rotorua, we finally caught up with them. Two sisters packing up their lives again.
Me and my sister, we've been through everything together and we're still going through everything together.
Aidan says she and her baby were unfairly evicted from their transitional house early last month, so Jax and her kids went with her.
We slept in our tents, used blankets as mattresses. So our kids ended up getting sick. They got bitten up from the mozzies head to toe.
What's happening next? Where are you going now?
Oh my God, we've got good news. We've actually been, we've found our emergency housing and it's here in Tauranga. And we don't have to worry about where we're going to go to next. And I'm about to cry. We have somewhere to go after this.
Will you go back to Rotorua?
No, we're not safe there anymore. Yeah, and I just feel so free over here. I haven't seen one Visions truck and it feels so good. Like, yes. We don't get harassed by any securities. Yeah, because there are none.
A new start for Aidan, Jax and their tamariki. But what about those left behind by Rotorua's emergency housing system? With a baby on the way, Sarita is living in a bus.
There's one, two, three, four, five, six of us.
And so you'd rather be there than at a Visions Run motel?
Yep.
My cheese is hot.
Mike, Lucky and Cruz continue to wait for a proper place to call home.
Are you pretty keen to get out of here?
Yeah, out of this motel, yeah. Can't wait. Been waiting for it.
And Carolyn worries about the future of her town and the Golden Mile that's lost its shine.
Why are you speaking out about this?
Because I care about Rotorua. I care about our whenua. I care about our kaumātua and our tamariki. You can't just keep piling this into one little area and expecting it to fix itself.
Well, as you heard, Housing Minister Megan Wood said she'd look into fresh allegations against Tiny Dean and his organisations. We put a number of these allegations to her office, who told us they were not new and the ministry has been dealing with them. But the women in our story say they haven't spoken to the ministry.